Donald Trump told his own supporters they could not pass a cognitive test to screen for dementia. Meanwhile, even Fox News of all networks essentially told Trump to shut up after he was ordered to pay a stunning $83 million in the E. Jean Carroll defamation trial. For more on this, it's time for a closer look. It's easy to forget, but there is still a person named Nikki Haley, and she is still running against Donald Trump. And I will say there's something very karmic about her candidacy. Like, you know how Donald Trump is so irritating to the rest of us? How we wake up every day asking, why the f*** are you still here? That's how Donald Trump feels about Nikki Haley. He wants her to go away so badly, but she's still in the race, and she's ramping up her attacks on him, focusing specifically on his mental state.
There are multiple things that I think are the reason he should not be president. That's the whole reason I'm running. I do think that he is in decline.
On election night, we were super excited. We had moved 25 points in the 3 weeks leading up to the election. And Donald Trump was totally unhinged. Unhinged.
I like to imagine that when Trump heard that, he reacted very calmly, just quietly took the remote, switched off the TV, and turned to his assembled team to say, "That's a very unfair characterization." Of my myriad of public statements, I'll admit that I make the occasional verbal faux pas. But that's no reason to stoop to ad hominem attacks. Is there no place left in the political arena for civility? That's my query for you, Birdman Haley. Now, calling Trump unhinged is both correct and a little rich coming from Nikki Haley, who worked under Trump as his UN ambassador in 2017 and 2018, a time no one recalls as the hinged years. The books about that time have titles like Peril and Rage, Not All Good and Fully on the Hinges. So apologies that when you say he's unhinged, we don't lean forward and say, tell us more, Nikki. I get that you probably don't watch this show, but we've been saying that for 10 years. If I even hover my finger over the letter U on my keyboard, it autofills unhinged. And in typical Trump fashion, he has reacted to the accusation that he's unhinged by acting unhinged. First, by comparing himself to a racehorse.
You know, I had an uncle. He's the longest-serving professor, Dr. John Trump, in the history of MIT. Same genes. We have genes. We're smart people. We're smart people, you know? We're like race... Mr. Lieutenant Governor, we're like racehorses, too. You know, the fast ones produce the fast ones, and the slow ones doesn't work out so well, right?
He's your uncle. People pay stud fees for the Triple Crown winner, not his brother. What's the stud fee for American Pharoah? Ooh, 180K. It's a little rich for my blood. He got a brother? Dave the horse? Yeah, let's do that. Also, the main thing racehorses are known for is speed, which is just not your thing. I'd love to see a horse named Donald Trump in the Kentucky Derby. And they're off. Sailor's Delight is in the lead, followed closely by Shooting Star. And all the way in the rear, why, it's Donald Trump, who seems to be wandering aimlessly in circles. He has no idea where he is or what he's doing. Looks like his next stop is going to be the glue factory. That was not the end of Trump's rant about his mental acumen. He then talked once again about the cognitive test he took in the White House, the one where they screen you not for super intelligence, but for dementia, and told his own audience that most of them could not pass it.
The first couple of questions are easy, like they'll have a lion, a giraffe, a whale, and a shark. And they'll say, which one's the lion, okay? Or they give you six names in a row. I took a lot of heat on this. They give you six names in a row at the beginning. Sir, I'm going to give you six names. Good. They look at them. A chair, a hat, a badge, a necklace, and they vote. Those things. We're going to give you six things. And I say, good, what's going on? Can you rename them? So I name them. Then they go back, and if you can do it in order, that's even better. I do them in order? Perfect. Then they come back to you 30 minutes later at the end, last question. They say, what were those six things? That there aren't too many people. And I get, they laughed. Everyone said, oh, that's so easy. There's only about 2% of this room can do it, but I did it. I did it very easily. But I got mocked. They said, oh, that's so easy. It's not easy. It's not easy.
Historically, it would be considered a gaffe when a candidate for higher office told a group of voters they're so dumb only 2% of them could answer which one is the lion. But Trump does it, and it gets an applause break. I guess America is divided, and I'm in the half whose reaction to that be, mother, I can find the lion. Also, the hard part doesn't even sound hard. Here, let's go back to this example.
They give you six names in a row at the beginning. Sir, I'm going to give you six names. Good. They look at them. A chair, a hat, a badge, a necklace, and they vote.
One problem, that's five things. Are you underreporting the number of things for tax purposes? Also, he definitely got those five things from just looking around.
They give you six things: a microphone, a teleprompter, a retiree, a plane, or a bird. This is too far away, I can't tell. And another teleprompter.
But other than that, you nailed it. Although, what Trump said right after that would also be worrying to me if I was a medical professional.
We're going to give you six things. And I say, good, what's going on?
It's probably not ideal in the middle of your dementia screening test to say the words, what's going on? That's the first thing they teach you at Kaplan Dementia Prep.
You know, I aced the test. They brought me into this room, and I said, where am I? And they said, Mr. President. And I was like, who are you talking to? And then they put up six fingers, one, two, three, four, six. And then I said, what's going on? I shouldn't be here. I'm supposed to be running in the Kentucky Derby. And the doctor said, congratulations, you aced the test. And I said, that's why my name is Dr. John Trump.
But Trump did not stop there. He's been obsessed with this topic. In a recent interview with Fox News, he cited, as his expert witness, his former White House doctor, Ronnie Jackson.
I think I'm a lot sharper than her. I would do this. I would sit down right now and take an aptitude test, and it would be my result against her result, and she's not going to win. She's not going to even come close to winning. In fact, when I heard the word cognitive, you know, I've taken two of them now. I took one with Doc Ronnie, who's now a fantastic, you know, White House doctor, and a fantastic congressman from Texas.
I personally would not cite as my sole medical expert a guy who was allegedly called the Candyman for the way he handed out pills and who was detained by police at a rodeo. That's a real thing that happened. He reportedly cursed at state troopers and had to be pinned to the ground. As a rule, when at a rodeo, try not to behave in a way that makes you look like an event at a rodeo. In his defense, they were probably just out to get Dr. Ronnie because he was a Republican. We all know how liberal rodeo cops are. If that happened to mine, hey, man, I'm watching Matt out. What do you mean he's giving you a hard time? If that happened to my doctor, I think I'd find someone else. Sorry, I'm late to surgery. I just got in a scuffle with police at a rodeo. Tried to give one of the bulls some Adderall, and I guess that's against the rules now. Anyway, enough about me. Let's find your appendix. In fact, if I were Trump, I would avoid citing the expertise of his White House medical unit altogether after details of a bizarre scandal involving prescription drugs emerged recently. According to a damning new report, the White House medical unit had severe and systemic problems with its pharmacy operations and provided health care to ineligible staffers. The probe focused on a three-year period during the Trump administration. The White House medical unit dispensed prescription medications, including controlled substances, to ineligible White House staff. Wait a second. You're telling me this guy might have been on pills? I don't want to speculate because we don't know, but also, come on, we know. The mood swings, the insomnia, the dry mouth, the incoherent babbling. He's the human embodiment of the scroll at the end of a drug commercial. He looks like he took Viagra and it worked on every part of his body except his penis. According to the report, controlled medications, including the sleeping pill Ambien and the stimulant Provigil, were dispensed without verifying the patient's identity. A witness told investigators that one doctor asked if I could hook up this person with some Provigil as a parting gift for leaving the White House. In the unit, it was authorized for us to do that kind of stuff. I work at show business, and even I have never been offered Provigil as a parting gift. I once went to the NBC doctor and said, hey, I need a little pick-me-up before the show, and they made me sign 50 forms, and then gave me two non-drowsy Sudafeds and a bill. What's especially notable about this report is that right-wing media used to claim, without any evidence, that Joe Biden was the one who was on drugs.
His staff, supervised by Dr. Jill, his wife, was giving him pills before every public appearance, checking the time and at a certain hour giving him a dose of something. Now, that's not a guess. We're not making that up. We've spoken directly to someone who was there and saw it happen multiple times. Now, before taking the medication, this person said, Biden was, quote, like a small child. You could not communicate with him. He changed completely because he was on drugs, and he clearly still is on drugs.
We're not making that up. We've spoken to someone who was there and saw it happen multiple times. His name is Devin. He's 16, and he works at the mobile station. He told me he sold drugs to Joe Biden, and I believe him because he sold drugs to me, too. But when I got home, I opened the baggie and realized it wasn't marijuana. It was just pencil shavings. I'd been pranked. So I went back to the mobile station to confront Devin and ask for my $100 back, but he laughed at me. So I asked to speak to his manager, Kyle, who was also 16 and also laughed at me. So I tried to jump over the counter to get the real weed, but it was higher than it looked, and I hit my knee and I fell backwards into a rack of adult magazines. And while embarrassed, I also became visibly aroused. And everyone in the gas station started laughing at me. So I closed my eyes and thought of the only thing that makes me happy, the sexy green M&M. And that's how I know Joe Biden uses drugs. For any other president, finding out that the White House medical unit was handing out pills like a party favor would be a pretty big scandal. But of course, for Trump, it barely even registers because he, you know, everything else. In the E. Jean Carroll defamation trial, for example, a jury on Friday ordered Trump to pay a stunning $83 million. And even Fox News drew the conclusion that Trump should maybe just stop talking.
In New York, a jury is ordering former President Donald Trump to pay more than $83 million in a defamation lawsuit brought by E. Jean Carroll.
The whole point of this enormous damages amount, unprecedented damages amount, is to tell Donald Trump to shut up. Stop attacking people who are no longer public citizens. Stop attacking people where you've already lost and the court has already said what you've done is liable. By continuing to defy the court by saying these things, he's showing a fundamental disrespect for the justice system and for the views of his fellow citizens, the jurors. I mean, this is not a judge who's punishing him. This is a randomly selected jury of his peers.
You know what's bad when even Fox News, the network that gives Trump unfiltered airtime, is telling him to shut up? 83 million really is a shocking number. That's three times the supposed market value of Mar-a-Lago. Trump would have to sell Mar-a-Lago three times. The only person who would fall for that is Rudy Giuliani. And he doesn't have the money either. But that's the only way to teach Trump any lessons, through his wallet. He doesn't care about anything else, although good luck getting him to pay. When they show up to collect the money, Trump's gonna take off like our close biological cousin, the racehorse. This is a presidential election. Ideally, it would be about policy and the things that actually affect people's lives. Instead, a guy who's been found liable for defamation and sexual abuse is spending most of his time bragging about acing a dementia test. If Trump is going to pay that $83 million, he might have to sell off some of his personal belongings, like, say,
a chair, a hat, a badge, a necklace, and a vote.
This has been A Closer Look. Hey, everybody, thanks for watching A Closer Look. And as a reminder, my brother Josh and I have started a new podcast called Family Trips with the Meyers Brothers. We hope you listen. We hope you like it. And see you soon.